Hello and welcome. Today, we're going to pull back the curtain and really get into the hidden connections that make our economy tick. You know, it's this fascinating, delicate balancing act, and we are going to break it all down. Right, so you hear about these things all the time. Government spending, interest rates, business investment. It kind of feels like they're all these separate forces, right? Well, what if I told you they are locked together in this powerful, predictable relationship? By the end of this, you'll see exactly how a single decision in one area sends ripples through all the others. Okay, so let's dive in. And to do that, we first have to meet the three main players on our economic stage. Once you understand these, you're on your way to seeing the bigger picture. First up, we've got consumption, which we'll just call C. This is pretty simple. It's everything we, as individuals and households, buy. You know, your groceries, a new phone, that morning coffee. The key thing here is that what we spend is tied directly to our disposable income. That's the money we have left after the government takes its cut in taxes. Next, we have investment, or I. Now, quick clarification. This is not about buying stocks and bonds. In macroeconomics, investment means businesses spending real cash on physical stuff to help them produce more. Things like a brand new factory, a fleet of delivery trucks, or upgraded computers. And this is super sensitive to the interest rate, because that's basically the cost of borrowing the money to fund those big projects. And our third player is government spending, or G. This is pretty much what it sounds like. Everything the government buys and provides, from building highways and bridges to funding the military. Now, for our purposes here, we treat this as a fixed amount. It's a policy decision made by lawmakers, kind of outside the day-to-day economic forces we're looking at. All right, so we have met our players, C, I, and G, consumption, investment, and government spending. Now, this is where it gets really cool, because they all have to fit together perfectly inside this sort of master equation for the economy. Let's see how that works. So this is it. This is the fundamental rule of the game. The total value of everything an economy produces, we call that Y, for yield or output, must equal the sum of everything spent. So that's consumption plus investment plus government spending. You can think of it like an unbreakable law of accounting for the entire country. Now, stay with me, because this is where a little bit of high school algebra reveals something amazing. If we take our main equation and just shuffle it around a bit, we can isolate investment, or I, on one side. So what's left on the other? Well, it's the total output of the economy minus what households consumed and what the government spent. And what do you call the money that's produced but not spent? You call it savings, specifically national savings, or S. And boom, there it is. This is the big reveal. All the money saved by everyone in the economy, that's you, me, and the government, all combined, that is the exact same pool of money that's available for businesses to invest. They have to be equal. One literally cannot exist without the other. It's a perfect balance. So we've just proved in theory that savings has to equal investment. But how does it actually happen in the real world? Like, what's the mechanism that makes sure this balance holds? Well, it turns out there's a specific marketplace where these two forces meet head on. And that place is what economists call the market for loanable funds. Don't let the fancy name fool you. It's a really simple idea. On one side, you've got savings, which is the supply of money that's available to be lent out. And on the other side, you've got investment, which is the demand from businesses that want to borrow that money. So just like in the market for, I don't know, apples or cars, there has to be a price that goes up or down to make sure supply meets demand. So what do you think the price is in this market for money?
Yep, you got it. It's the interest rate, which we'll call R. The interest rate is literally the price of borrowing. It's the magic dial that turns up or down to ensure that the amount of money people and the government want to save perfectly matches the amount of money that businesses want to borrow and invest. Okay, so now we have our working model of the economy. Let's put it to the test. Let's run a little simulation of something that happens all the time in the real world. The government decides it needs to spend more money.
This is the million-dollar question, right? When G increases, what happens to our neat little S equals I balance? Does it just break? No, let's trace the effects step by step using what we've learned.
Okay, so remember, national savings is made of two pieces, private savings, what we save, and government savings. So when government spending, G, goes up, but taxes, T, don't change, the government is simply saving less money, or more likely, it's borrowing more. Either way, because of that, the entire pool of national savings shrinks. So the chain reaction here is crystal clear. The government spends more, that directly causes government savings to fall, and that, in turn, shrinks the entire supply of savings that's available in the economy for everybody else.
And this predictable chain reaction has a name. It's one of the most famous and important concepts in all of macroeconomics, and it's a really powerful idea for understanding what happens when governments make big policy changes.
I want you to go back to that market for loanable funds in your head. The total supply of savings has just shrunk, right? So if you were drawing this on a graph, the whole supply line would shift inward, to the left. There's just less money available to be borrowed than there was a moment ago. And what happens in any market when supply goes down but demand stays the same? The price goes up. It's Econ 101. So now you have more businesses competing for a smaller pool of money. That competition pushes the interest rate higher. And of course, when borrowing gets more expensive, what do businesses do? Well, they borrow less and they invest less. This whole sequence of events is called crowding out. By needing to borrow more to finance its own spending, the government effectively elbows private companies out of the way in the line for money. It crowds them out, leading to those higher interest rates and less private investment. And that's the crucial takeaway here. It's this direct cause and effect connection. A single policy decision, hey, let's increase government spending, had a predictable two-part consequence on the private sector. It's just a perfect illustration of how deeply interconnected all these parts of the economy really are. You know, this really gets at a fundamental truth at the heart of economic policy. There's really no such thing as free money. Our model shows that for every dollar the government decides to spend, it could mean there's a dollar that a private company doesn't get to invest in a new factory or breakthrough technology or new jobs. It's the classic economic trade-off. So the next time you hear a debate about some massive new government program, you'll know the hidden question to ask. What innovation, what private growth, what future is being crowded out to pay for it?